What's up? Welcome to another episode of Handles. My name is Lorenzo, and I have a quick question for you. How many finish lines have you crossed in your life? Pretty simple. How many finish lines have you crossed in your life? Whether competing, whether it's something from a scholar perspective, academic perspective, how many stopping points or finish lines have you crossed in your life? So this is interesting. What if I told you that finish lines don't exist? They're myths, fraudulent. Stick with me. I think you'll start to figure out where I'm going with this.
Everyone has a grip on life. Everybody feels like they have a handle. Afraid to share the mistakes, the stories are what connect us. They are the key. We're running out of time.
So I'm a teenager at this specific part of my life, and I'm participating in something we call summer track. Just track and field. It's from an AAU perspective. You've probably heard from it before. So what I was doing is doing more track than I was field, but I like to do the running events. So I'm learning different things when it comes to this. And at this time, I'm running things like hurdles and relays, and I'm enjoying myself. Well, at this specific track meet, I'm out on the field, warming up, getting ready to start my event, right? The event I'm going to participate in. But at this point, they have different age groups in AAU, or summer track and field. Stick with me if you already know this. So, you may have ages from like 5 to 10, 10 to 15, 15 to 20, so on and so forth. But the age group that was running at this particular moment was the youngest age group. I mean, you got boys and girls out there that are about maybe 6, 7 years old, maybe a little bit less than that. But they're just trying to get around the track, trying to keep their attention focused on whatever it is, which is a hassle in itself, right? So you can imagine kids on the track, their parents are trying to help them get in their lane, stay in their lane, stop playing with Joey on the left or Jane on the right, and you're just gonna run all the way down this track, staying in this lane, and once you get to the finish line, you're done, we'll be there to greet you. Pretty simple, right? So these kids are running what we call the 100 meters. You've probably heard of it before. So I just happened to look up to see a set of boys that are running the 100 meters. And they're running and the crowd is all happy. Some are giggling. Everybody's got their cameras out, taking pictures. You know, some of the kids have lost their focus, so they're smiling and waving at mom in the middle of the race. But I noticed there's one kid that is 100% focused. He's running with like perfect form, keeping his head straight, arms are pumping the right way, knees are high, and he's not winning the race. He's maybe in third or fourth place. But I notice as they get to the finish line, the kids that were in front of him, finishing before him, of course, got to the finish line, leaned across the tape like they were taught, and immediately stopped. Well, this particular athlete, this particular kid, gets to the finish line, and I notice the momentum isn't stopping. This guy is continuing to run. So if you don't know, 100 meters is a straight line on a track. At this point, he's hitting the curve. So now he is still sprinting around the curve. And people in the audience or in the stands are now noticing. So they're thinking it's the cutest thing ever, right? They're giggling, they're pointing, they're saying, this is so awesome, how cute is that kid? Somebody stop him. So you see some of the officials and the referees are running over to him and say, hey, kid, you can stop. The race was over back there, you can stop. And he's just pumping away. He's going all the way around the curve. And I notice when he gets all the way around the curve, there's a gentleman standing at the end of the curve. He runs directly to that gentleman, stops, leans over, starts to catch his breath. He's talking to this individual. The refs, the officials catch up with him. They try to write down his name to make sure he tells them what place he gets, if he gets a ribbon, so on and so forth. But the stands were going crazy, right? They just loved it, thought it was the cutest thing ever. But I thought something was awkward about this. So later on in the track meet, the same athlete, right? The same guy is running now the 200 meters, which starts the curve and ends on a straight. So his race begins. I notice he has the same form, same focus, and he's just pumping away as he goes around this curve into the straight. He's not winning the race once again. At this point, he's maybe fifth or sixth out of eight athletes that are on the track. He's maybe fifth or sixth. But he's just using his form, he's focused, he's not paying attention to anything else. So all the kids in front of him, the athletes in front of him, once they get to the finish line, they stop, right? They lean over, start catching their breath. So this time, I make sure I stop to see what this guy's gonna do. And what does he do? Continues running. Once again, everybody in the stands starts laughing, giggling, pointing, saying how cute this is. They pull out their cameras, oh, how awesome it is. And you have these officials chasing him down again, right? But he goes around the curve. So at this point, he's running 300 meters. Not just a 200, a 300 meter race. But I remembered that he was running towards a specific figure at the end of that race. Sure enough, that figure is there again at the 300 meter mark. He runs directly to this guy, stops, leans over, catches his breath, and begins to have a conversation. The officials catch up to the kid, tell him, hey, you ran a little bit further than you needed to, but we need your name. This was your specific number. This is your place, and here's your ribbon. Kid thanks him. Both him and the gentleman walk off into the stands. Now, I'm curious at this point. I gotta know what's going on. Once was a mistake, right? An accident, maybe something we just didn't think through totally. But that second time, no. That was on purpose. So there's a reason for this. Now, I didn't know the kid, and I didn't know the specific gentleman that he was with either. I'm assuming he had to be either a coach or maybe a father figure, don't know. But I just happened to go to the concession stand. My races were over for the day, and I was gonna enjoy myself with some candy. I'm sure you already know that about me. So I go to the concession stand, and who's down there? You guessed it, the athlete and the figure. Had no choice. Had to walk up to him and ask him. So I walk up to the adult at the time, the figure, the man that he was running to, and I said, hey, look, my name's Lorenzo. I just gotta tell you, got a hell of an athlete on your hands here. I mean, what's his story? And the gentleman says, look, I appreciate it. Thanks a lot. It's my son, and I'll let him tell you what he does. And so his son, whose name is Tyler, begins to tell me that he enjoys track and this, that, and the other, and he's trying to work on certain things, i.e. his breathing, i.e. his form, and his focus. I said, well, kid, you're knocking it out the park. You're doing all three of those things better than I am, so keep it up. So I look back at Dad and I say, if you don't mind me asking, why does he always run past the finish line? So he looks me dead in the eyes. And he says, I'm working with my son to teach him that in life, there's no such thing as a finish line. Huh. Blew me away. So it got me thinking. In life, we're taught about finish lines, stopping points, limits, end results. Something that cuts off our ability to move forward. Something that stops us because it's a pinpoint for us, or we've reached whatever those specific results were, so we are now able to stop. Well, Tyler's father was teaching him that there's no such thing. There's no limits to those specific ideas. And I thought that was unique. So think about this. Your mind is your best friend, your number one advocate, number one ally, number one promoter. Would do anything you ask it to do, right? You decide to go to the track one day because you want to jog a mile, four laps around that track. Your mind takes that commitment and says, I think that's a great idea. I'm here for you, 100% supporter. So it begins to formulate a plan of action and disseminate that information throughout your body to ensure that you make it around that track the four times that you initially requested. Your mind is 100% behind you. So what it does is it tells your muscles, hey, we have to stretch a little bit extra while we get on this track. We need to make sure we drink a little bit more water before we move forward. We have to ensure that we're working on our breathing prior to and during our run. It does whatever it needs to do to make sure that you get those four laps that you've committed it to. But something happens. Either before you start running or during your run, you say to yourself, it sure is kind of muggy out here. My foot sure was bothering me a little bit earlier. I think I wore the wrong clothing. There's other people running around the track and they're probably paying attention to me. And it's throwing all this information to your mind. So then you decide, I think I'll just run two laps. Your number one supporter, your number one ally, your best friend, your number one advocate says, I think that's a great idea, boss, let's do it. So now your mind says, instead of the four laps that you initially committed to, we're just gonna run two. It starts to disperse that information, disseminate it throughout the body, and now your body's ready to run two laps. Pretty simple, huh? Let me give you another example. You feel like you need to lose weight to get in better shape. And one of the things that you have focused on is your eating habits. So with that, you've decided that you want to eat healthier and you want to eat less proportions. Great. So you tell yourself before you go to the dinner table that no matter what is out there for dinner, I'm only going to eat half of it. Your number one ally, your best friend, your number one advocate, the number one promoter says, great job, boss. I think we should do it. Let's knock it out. It starts to formulate a plan of action, send that information throughout your body and says, in order for us to only eat half of our meal, we need to drink more liquids. We need to chew our food a little bit longer. We need to take a little bit more time between each bite. And we need to make sure that we give our body enough time to digest. If we do that the right way, we will only eat half of the meal that's put on our plate, and we will feel full. Your mind puts it all in place for you. You go downstairs, you get in front of dinner, and you realize your parents, your loved ones, your significant other has made your favorite food, your favorite meal. So now you throw another message to your mind. This is bullshit. I'm about to eat all of this. This is my favorite meal. I don't care. And I'm going to enjoy the dessert that comes after this. Your mind says, oh, that sounds awesome. Let's do it. I'm 100% behind you. So it formulates a plan of action for you, disperses that information, disseminates it throughout the body, and now your body's ready to enjoy the entire meal that's sitting in front of you. And it's even going to leave room for dessert. I use those two examples to make sure you understand that your mind will do whatever you tell it to. We just tell it to do so much. The one thing your mind can't control is the things you decide to embrace, the things you decide to absorb. So it can't tell you not to watch TV. It can't tell you not to pay attention to all the social media stuff. It can't tell you to stop listening to your friends that are still overweight. It can't tell you that you don't need that extra dessert. It can't tell you any of those things. All it can do is support you with whatever you decide to do. So if you send that message up there that you want to do ABCD, it's your number one advocate. It will do it for you. I haven't seen Tyler since that day at the track meet. Don't know where he is in life, don't know how his father's doing, have no idea. But I can only imagine the accomplishments that young man has made up to this point in his life, strictly from how his father taught him to approach the idea of finish lines. So I have two points I'd love for you to take away from this. The first thing is start sending your mind one message, one focus, one target, one aim, and watch it do the work for you. The second thing is you gotta ask yourself, how much more accomplished would you be if you started living life today as if there were no such thing as finish lines? Thanks for hanging with me on another episode of Handles. I sure hope this added value. If it did, don't forget to subscribe to this channel. Hit that bell so you're alerted anytime new material comes out. And if you want more Handles, you can follow me on any one of my social media handles, or right here at the bottom of the screen, you can follow me at my website. Thanks again so much for your support, your patience, and your feedback. I'll catch you guys next time, right here on Handles.